Very good morning to one and all present here. It is my pleasure to welcome you all to the National Entrepreneurship Summit of IIM Bangalore, Van Hussein Eximius 2015. Our summit's theme, Let's Get Started, aims to celebrate the passionate zeal of entrepreneurs to solve problems around them. And the advent of technology and the internet has ensured that impact can be more sustainable and long-lasting than ever before. One such story of impact is the story of e-commerce in India. It has not only revolutionized the way we shop, it has revolutionized the way we live. With this note, ladies and gentlemen, it is my privilege to introduce to you our keynote speaker, board chairman of Myntra and head of commerce at Flipkart, and one of the pioneers of India's e-commerce story, Mr. Mukesh Bansal. Mukesh, sir, spent close to 10 years in multiple early-age startups in Silicon Valley, such as Nextag, eWanted, Centrata, and NewScale, where he held various senior management positions in product management, marketing, and product development. He then co-founded Myntra in 2007. Myntra is among the leading e-commerce companies in India and a default destination for fashion and lifestyle products, with over 1,000 brands under its banner and a brand presence in more than 450 cities. Today's session has been a much-awaited occasion for all of us, and without further ado, I invite Mr. Bansal to address all present. Mr. Bansal has been gracious enough to agree to address our audience despite not keeping well today. We're really thankful to him. In light of this, the session will be a shortened one.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you. I was not a little bit under the weather, but I think I'm all right today. What I thought is, since the whole summit is about entrepreneurship, and what I understand from many of you folks in the audience are also interested at some point in your career taking entrepreneurship seriously, I'll just mostly talk about my journey so far, some of the experience, few things I have learned, and then maybe touch upon few things about some of the big trends that are happening in the internet space in India. And towards the end, we'll take some questions. So it's been a long journey for me. Started almost 17, 18 years ago. I did my BTech in computer science from IIT Kanpur. And I got quite interested, probably like many of the students here during my third year, to think seriously about entrepreneurship. Just started exploring few things and reading a lot about entrepreneurship. And sometime during third or fourth year, I got convinced that long term, the whole process of building a business from scratch is very meaningful. In many ways, an entrepreneur, move societies forward by creating new things, taking a lot of risk. Many fail also in the process, but that appealed to me. And I more or less decided on that's what I want to do. I ended up getting a job with a large company out of campus. I worked with them for 2 years, I really didn't enjoy that stint all that much. So in 99, this was the height of dot-com boom in US, I moved to Bay Area and joined a startup. From 99 till 2007, I worked for 4 different startups in Silicon Valley. First couple of them were consumer internet space, and the next two were enterprise software. And those 8 years were really very helpful for me to learn about entrepreneurship. All those companies that I joined were mostly less than 10% old, so I'm just 3-4 people when I joined them. So I got to see, work with those entrepreneurs and the investors very closely, and see how they go about building business. The process of creating a business from scratch is very, very messy. You stumble almost every day, a lot of false steps. You are continuously course correcting, adjusting, changing the business model. But it's great for me to, kind of learn from the sidelines and also contribute to those companies' progress. The first one, Nextag, eventually went on to have a fairly large exit, more than $1 billion. Second one, eWanted, they fizzled out within 2 years. Third one, Centrata, where I spent actually a lot of time. Eventually, they also didn't work out. And last one, NewScale, they sold to Cisco for about $150 million or so. So during that time in Bay Area and working with all those startups, I learned about, first and foremost, about just overall startup culture in Bay Area. It's not a coincidence. Most of the big technology we use, they were all, majority of them are created out of Silicon Valley, because there's a whole environment there that's been built over last 20, 30 years, where It's very common for fresh graduates to start a company. Failure is quite acceptable. You may have one or two failure, and then you may do something, or you may go back to do a job. It's very much accepted. The culture is very, very meritocratic. So often in where you'll find that you are working for a CEO who is 23-year-old, and it's not an anomaly. Everyone is comfortable with that. The notion of transparency. So companies are very liberal about sharing almost everything, with the basic belief is, if you have a good talent working for you and you share all the information, people will be empowered. They will be able to do their job more effectively. So companies go out of their way to share almost everything that's going on, all the good, bad, and ugly, instead of just having all hands share all the good news, but hide everything else from the company. If you don't share what's wrong, people will not be able to contribute to that. So there's a number of things. So overall, my stint in Bay Area during those 8 years really informed my thinking around how to go about building a very strong foundation for culture, to pay a lot of attention to the core values that the company will believe in. And I've really tried to apply that learning to what we have done at Mintra. It's a fairly unique culture, I would like to believe. We are very clear about core values, and over a period of time, it becomes one of the key salient point of why the company is able to work. We are trying some of those things at Flipkart as well. Second thing, what I learned over there was the need to be very pragmatic. So, if you start with an idea, usually most entrepreneurs, when you come up with an idea, there is certain passion, about that. You feel in your gut that you can make this idea work. You almost sometimes fall in love with that idea, and you have to, right? Otherwise, most entrepreneurs start with almost everyone telling you, why it will not work. You will yourself find data that it will not work. There are a lot of rejection involved. So you need to have, on one hand, that absolute conviction that you are able to ignore a lot of people's opinion. But it's also possible that you are going down the wrong path. So how do you balance that? At some point, you also need to be able to confront the reality and course correct when needed, right? So that's a very, very difficult balance to have, to balance almost two opposite sentiments. One is very, very deep conviction about what you are doing. Second, at some point, to be able to recognize that perhaps the way you have envisioned the business model or about the market or consumers, that's not the reality. So in Bay Area, I had seen some companies do that very well. They started with one path, changed course once or twice, and then make the business model work. I've seen companies who will keep going down one path because the founder had such a deep conviction where the writing was a wall, that's not going to work, and eventually that'll lead to death of the company. But you can have other example also where you're very fickle, you're continuously changing, and that is also not going to take you somewhere. So I think that learning, again, was very helpful to me as we were shaping the Mintra journey. I think some of you may know the Mintra history. We started off as a very niche personalization website, selling customized t-shirts, mugs, calendars, etc. online. We did that for 3-4 years. In fact, IIM Bangalore was one of our customers. We supplied a lot of personalized t-shirts to IIM Bangalore. But by 2010, a couple of things were clear to us. One is that was a very niche business. One can build a maybe 30, 40, 50 crore business, but not 500 crore, 1,000 crore business selling personalized products. Second thing that was happening around us is we could see the internet was really starting to take off. From 2000 to 2007 to 2010, which was first 4 years of Mintra's journey, the internet growth was very, very slow. There's a very small number of broadband users, some internet connectivity through office, but not much going on. So looking at how fast internet was starting to grow and realizing that personalization will not scale beyond a certain limit. But given that we were in the space for last 4 years, we had our team in place, technology platform in place, supply chain in place. So we felt that if we go after a much larger consumer category, we can build a much larger business. So we looked at different categories and settled on fashion, primarily because fashion is one very large category in India. You know, at the time, it was about $50 billion in size. Today, about $75, $80 billion. And, you know, a few years will cross $100 billion in size. Significantly underpenetrated by organized retail. There are less than, I think, 5-6% of all fashion is served by organized retail and brands. So there's a huge gap. And also, it's a category with good ASPs and a good margin. So everything added up. So we decided to change the business model, launch fashion, you know, change Myntra completely from personalization to fashion, and launch the fashion portal in early 2011. It was a hard decision. If you can imagine, you work on building something for 4 years, you are known for that, your brand is known for that, and shutting it all down completely and aligning everybody from your board members, investors who invested for that business model, employees who joined you for that, to start from scratch. It was a difficult journey, but I think we managed it well. We launched our fashion portal in early 2011. Again, if you guys remember, in those days, the two large players in the fashion space, in the online space, were Fashion and You and YeB. So we were, you know, kind of coming from behind. But because we had strong foundation, very strong team, deep customer focus, I think we were able to execute quite well. And by end of 2012, we were the largest online fashion player, and, you know, continue to make good progress since then. So that's, I think, going back to, you know, my learning in Silicon Valley about being able to pivot the business model and then being able to do that successfully in Myntra has been a, you know, big part of what made, you know, I think Myntra what it is today. If we stayed on with the personalization, we would have been a very small niche, you know, player in that. So some of the other things that, you know, I've learned, which is very important as you grow the business. One is at the starting day, the founding team, I think, is very important. You know, so the initial 2-3 people, it's very important to get the team right. You know, you need to have people who have, you know, equal commitment and passion to what you are trying to build. You need to have very open, transparent relationship. The founders of the company, initially, you will be making a lot of very important decisions, and you'll have to make decisions very quickly. You'll also have to distribute responsibility between the among the founders. So that amount of trust and open, transparent communication is very, very important. As the company progresses, it's also important that all the founders, they hold very high bar. You know, what happens usually, a lot of them people start with a friend. And so you may have great relationship and communication, but everyone may not be equally competent. Eventually, you know, whichever space you are playing in, you can only win if you have a highly competent team where everyone is able to do their part of the job. So managing that equation, you know, among the founders as the company progresses, that this is what the role may be this much, you know, last year, but now it has grown to this thing, and are you still able to do justice to that or not? I think no one, you know, even if you're a founder, you should not stay on in the role if you are not the best person to do the job. So a lot of companies stumble, you know, in making the transition. If I look at Myntra, we have gone through almost 3 iterations of, you know, building the management team. The first batch that drove the business from 2007 to 2009-10, it was most people who were very entrepreneurial in nature. They, you know, people who wanted to join an early stage company, and they did, you know, really good job of taking Myntra from zero to a point where we had more than 50% market share personalization. But by the time we also realized we were a 100% company, and it required different kind of management leadership skills. And, you know, we went through a phase of hiring a lot of leaders from outside. Some of the existing folks left at that time, and this leadership team drove the business, you know, from transition from personalization to fashion and scaling in. It took us to number one position in fashion, but even when we were number one, we were, you know, only about 150, 200 crores size. From there to build a, you know, 2,000, 3,000 crore business was an entirely different journey, and some of the folks in the leadership team did not have a skill to plot that journey. So in 2013, we again focused on, you know, getting more senior people in the leadership team. That led to again another, you know, round of transition. And the current business is mostly driven by these folks, and they did manage to take the business from, you know, roughly from 200 crores at that time to almost so over 2,000 crores now and growing. So just managing that team aspect, you know, from as the business grows is, I think, is very, very important. So I talked about, you know, importance of building the right value and culture, importance of continuing to be very realistic, like to both, you know, find a balance between being committed as well as being very objective about what you're trying to build, ensuring any given part of the business you have a right team, that's very critical. So I guess, you know, these are the some of the three, you know, big things that in my journey of Myntra that I felt that is, you know, been quite helpful. And I would suspect that most business in their life cycle will face some of these, you know, will need to tackle, you know, these aspects. Now where we are at, you know, and for those of you who are thinking about entrepreneurship, I think it's a phenomenally exciting time to be an entrepreneur in India. And I'm not joking, sometime I wish, you know, I was starting out now, starting 8 years ago. You know, the ecosystem has evolved so much, you know, there's so much funding available. There is, you don't need to, if you want to start a business, you don't need to convince anyone, you know, why that's a good idea. I think there are enough success stories now. And also the size of the market is so big that, you know, you can easily build a case for, you know, whichever business model or the idea you're pursuing, the chances are you can arrive at least, you know, potentially fairly big market and get, you know, a lot of good people to join you. Just to, you know, given just portray contrast between, you know, now and 8 years ago, when we started out, you know, first we started out of a house in HSR layout, and when we used to call folks for interview, and some people will have somebody from, you know, the window watching outside, you know, guiding the candidate, and some candidates will come out, see this, you know, company is in house, and they will just turn back, will not even come in. To now, we are, you know, at Flipkart, we are very actively focused on hiring really senior leaders from Silicon Valley. And you know, we have some such folks join in last 6 months, you know, a few more are going to join. So imagine, you know, now Indian e-commerce story has become that big that we are able to go to probably the best place for technology talent in the world and create a proposition for them to willing to relocate. And it's not only Indians, you know, we have a couple of people who are American citizens. They are also in the process of moving to Bangalore for 3-4 year stint and participate in, you know, something that they also, you know, see. It's very exciting. There's opportunity to solve very unique problem, create a phenomenal scale. So it's, you know, huge. It's a great time to be an entrepreneur. You know, some of the stats all of you guys probably know already. We have almost 250 million internet users. Out of those, around 40 million or so shop online. The mobile penetration is, you know, that just I think massive trend. It's just completely upending how the internet business in India work. Mobile stats are, you know, even more staggering. In we have close to around 700 million mobile phone subscriptions, and all those people are, you know, almost simultaneously starting to upgrade to smartphones. Every year we are selling 100, this year we'll sell about 120 million smartphones, next about 150 million smartphones. So within 3 years, we'll have close to 300 to 400 million, right? So 30 to 40 crores people with smartphone access. No one's going to have a smartphone without any data connectivity. So you have such a massive, you know, you install base of consumers, you know, it's a, you know, if you think of 300, 400 million, that's, you know, the largest possible market anywhere in the world. And all of these guys will want access to what's available to consumers anywhere in the world, because a smartphone in your pocket with internet is hugely empowering. You have access to all the information. I think consumers in India are very aspirational. They want all the same things that are available to consumers anywhere in the world. So whether it's about online shopping or booking for tickets online or getting a taxi or, you know, now finding out where to stay at the short notice, you know, people will get used to doing all of it, you know, on their smartphone. So there are, you know, tons and tons of business opportunities around this. I think we're still, you know, only scratching the surface of what's possible on mobile. Mobile phones themselves are going through, they're evolving very rapidly. You know, everybody from hardware manufacturers to the operating system guys, and then on top of the app, the entire ecosystem is evolving very, very rapidly. The pace of innovation on mobile phones is, you know, absolutely staggering. So that's one, you know, big thing that, you know, any of you thinking of starting something should very seriously think about what role will mobile play in your business plan and consumer proposition. I don't think it's something, you know, you can afford to ignore. I think some of you probably know that at Myntra, we have decided to go mobile only just, you know, a couple of months ago, and I'm very, very excited about that change. I think that's helping us accelerate our pace of innovation on mobile phones. And in the process, we have, you know, disappointed some desktop consumers, but the reality is, you know, the desktop penetration is so small in India and not growing. You know, again, to just to share the contrast with you, in India we sell 3 million laptops every year versus, you know, 120 million smartphones. So there's a factor of 1:40. And the laptop numbers are not growing. Next year also it will be 3 million or less, while mobile phone numbers will be larger. And you can potentially, you know, have your service available on both devices, but the difference between the two is so much, you know, you almost need two different solutions. So for example, on mobile phone you have camera available, you know, laptop you don't. You can build a lot of use cases around camera phone. An example is that Flipkart, we recently launched visual search. So which basically means, you know, I can just take out my phone, go to Flipkart app, and let's say, you know, I can point to, you know, Brian's shirt, take his picture, and I will see all the shirts similar to that. Now you cannot do that on the desktop. Or the fact that consumer location is available at, you know, so we could know that the moment you're shopping that you are near Brigade Road and near a particular store, we can potentially know that what inventory is available in that store, and therefore we can show that selection and also tell user that, you know, if you want, you can pick it up in 15 minutes or 5 minutes, the store which is 15 minutes from, you know, or 5 minutes from where you are, and here is the also directions for you to get to that, right? It's, you know, when our delivery folks are going out for delivery, from the geolocation of the customer, they will know that this person right now in transit, so it's probably not a good time, right? There is, you know, these are just to give you a few examples. It's, we are increasing, getting more and more sensors on the smartphone. The compute power on smartphone is increasing. One big trend that's happening is, you know, the emergence of you know, what you call virtual agents. So those of you who use Apple Siri or now Google Now, these are really virtual, you know, intelligent virtual agent, and a lot of interfaces moving in that direction, where these agents, you know, will understand the consumers more and more deeply, and almost act like a virtual personal assistant to do whatever you want, you know, through mostly through voice. So even the touch, you know, will probably be not needed in a few years from now. You know, I'll share another, you know, personal example. I was in Europe recently, and you know, as you know, not many people speak English if you are in mainland Europe. Google Translate recently, you know, released their new app, which has a real-time bi-directional translation. So I actually had a conversation with a taxi driver where I will say something in English. Immediately Google Translate will say this thing in Spanish. This guy will reply in Spanish, and the app will again, you know, say it back in English to me. And that's possible among, I think, 30 languages. And you guys should try. Hindi is also there. You know, Hindi, in fact, few regional Indian languages. It's not perfect, but it's 80% of the way there, right? And this is today. I think few years from now, we'll not even have to think about it, right? So my larger point is the pace of innovation and what's starting to become possible on mobile phone is just of entirely different league altogether. You know, most of that stuff doesn't work on desktop, you know, and that's the reason why at Myntra we decided to focus on mobile only. Our belief is that we create a really compelling innovative experience on mobile that will be in future 90 to 95% of market anyway, And if we are innovative there, we should it should help us win the market, right? So and that's one. I think other one that's a trend that's seemed to be very big, but also a little overhyped is the whole hyperlocal business model. I think so at the core of it, there is genuine merit. I think if you look from e-commerce, you know, point of view, or from consumer consumption point of view, ultimately you're buying a good. That good needs to come to your house, and depending on what you are buying, you know, if you're buying a pizza, you want it to, you know, come to your place in 30 minutes, or if you're ordering, you know, food, you want it to come to you, you know, fairly quickly in a very predictable manner. So how does one build that entire supply chain, you know, across India? On the other hand, we have, you know, at the kind of semi-skilled end of the population, massive number of unemployed people. So you put two and two together, you know, create a technology framework to create one hand employment for these folks, and enable, you know, the real fast and also very cheap delivery of stuff to your house. I think, you know, that business model will work. Someone will figure out a way to do that. But there are a lot of unknowns. It's also a difficult business. Both encouraged by, you know, the number of startups which are trying to tackle this, but also I feel there is, you know, like it happens with any new trend, I think, you know, there is a bit of excess. So I think there are way too many companies, a lot of people trying different things there. So it will, you know, I think settle down over the next few years. But eventually at maturity, we should be, you know, I think all of us as consumers should benefit, you know, for almost anything, we should be able to get very reliable, predictable delivery of any consumer good that we can imagine, and that's, you know, going to make all of our life easier. So that's a kind of other big trend right now that's seeing a lot of entrepreneurial action. I can go on. Actually, there, you know, you can, if you sit back and see any area of consumption, you know, if you think about financial services, there's a massive opportunity for, you know, innovation. In India, we don't have any good digital payment instrument that all of us use, you know. Today in China, Alipay has become so prevalent and also so easy to use. You can use it online, offline, you can fund it whichever you want. And all you need is, I think, just your fingerprint. So your Alipay account is tied to your fingerprint. So literally I can walk into offline shop, I can, you know, bill whatever I want to bill, and I can put my fingerprint and the payment is, you know, taken care of. I don't need to carry anything in my wallet, right? Physical or digital, as an example. So that whole space still needs to be solved. Overall, you know, we don't have any kind of credit rating agency. You know, a lot of most economies in the world are powered by very sophisticated credit instruments for consumers. We don't have good credit rating. Therefore, credit is limited to very few people. So, you know, there are, you know, all kinds of areas which will see a lot of innovation. I think India will look a lot different 5 years from now. And that's the reason why I see. I think it's a great time to be an entrepreneur. You can almost pick any problem if you have the right team, if you're thinking about it creatively. And other thing I should say is, you know, if you are going to embark on entrepreneurship, think very long term. I think entrepreneurship is definitely not something you can do for 6 months, 1 year, 2 year. You need to have 4 or 5 year horizon. You know, it will be a difficult journey. You will, you know, mostly you will meet failures until, you know, you meet, you know, one success and slowly build upon your success. But it's very, very important to keep long-term horizon in mind. A lot of things will go wrong. Things may not work out with your co-founders. Right now, economic environment is great. It may change next year. So even though you are making good progress in the product, no one may fund you. So you need to ride out that time. You know, you may be building something you think is very cool, but consumers may reject it. So you need to be prepared to go back and rethink, get feedback, and, you know, all that you can do if you are persistent and you have long term in mind. If you get disheartened, discouraged, just, you know, 6 months, 1 year into it, and then you talk to your friends who are working for, you know, large companies or working at Flipkart and getting promotions and growing, you know, that's something very difficult to, you know, deal with. So you need to be really deep down, see that can you make a career out of entrepreneurship, and even if you put in 5 years and you do, if you don't see a business success, is the experience worth it? Is the learning worth it? Will you enjoy? I think if the answer is yes to those, it's absolutely the right thing for you to try your hand at entrepreneurship.